6 both days. It's kid-friendly and wheelchair accessible. For more information, visit liveoakparkfair.com.
You are listening to KPFA, KPFB in Berkeley, KFCF 88.1 in Fresno, and online at kpfa.org. Coming up next, the Morning Mix. Stay tuned.
Welcome to the Morning Mix. This is the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. I'm Mickey Huff in studio with Peter Phillips. It's Friday, May 31st, 2013. Today, we focus on the many conferences and activist summits taking place this weekend in the San Francisco Bay Area. We'll talk to the executive director of the Public Banking Institute, Mark Armstrong, and Birgitta Jonsdottir, who was recently reelected to the Iceland Parliament for the Pirate Party. In the second segment today, we interview Professor Christine Hong, the Korea Policy Institute, and Victor Monotti with the International Forum on Globalization regarding Moana Nui 2013, Peoples of the Pacific. And we finish the program today with an interview with Professor Lance DeHaven-Smith and Aaron Good addressing state crimes against democracy. But first, the KPFA News headlines. Please stay with us.
I'm Eileen Alfandari with news headlines. There are major delays on BART this morning. Trains are running through the Transbay Tube on just a single track as BART carries out repairs. Two maintenance vehicles working in the tube early this morning collided and damaged the third rail. The single tracking through the tube is having ripple effects throughout the entire BART system. Delays are expected to last through the morning commute. BART says the repairs will be completed in time for the afternoon commute. College students joined President Obama at the White House this morning as he called on Congress to keep federally subsidized student loan rates from doubling on July 1st.
So we cannot price the middle class or folks who are willing to work hard to get into the middle class out of a college education. We can't keep saddling young people with more and more and more debt just as they're starting out in life.
The event marked the beginning of a public campaign by Obama to temporarily extend current rates or to find a long-term compromise. Obama has proposed linking the rates to the financial markets and locking the rate in. The Republican-controlled House passed a plan last week that would recalculate the rates each year. Massachusetts Senator Elizabeth Warren introduced legislation to tie student loans to the same low rates big banks get when they borrow money from the Federal Reserve. The California Assembly has voted to give minimum wage workers their first raise in 6 years. Supporters of the legislation said the minimum wage has not kept pace with the rising cost of food, gasoline, rent, and other necessities. Democrat Luis Alejo of Watsonville said raising the minimum wage would have a positive ripple effect throughout the economy. His remarks were emailed to reporters.
Those extra dollars that they're earning per hour and at the end of each week are going to get reinvested back into our economy. Buying groceries, eating at local restaurants, paying their bills, paying their rent. It gets reinvested back into our state's economy.
Alejo's measure would increase California's minimum wage 25 cents to $8.25 an hour next year. It would rise to $9.25 by 2016 and then be adjusted for inflation into the future. Opponents argued that minimum wage jobs are often held by teenagers or those who soon move on to higher paid positions. But Alejo said his mother-in-law earned the minimum wage at one of her jobs for 20 years. Previously incarcerated Californians would have a better shot at a job under legislation approved by the state assembly. The so-called Ban the Box bill would prevent most employers from inquiring about previous criminal records on their job applications. Assemblyman Roger Dickinson said the measure would prevent formerly incarcerated people from being rejected out of hand.
By simply delaying the criminal background check inquiry, applicants will be given the opportunity to demonstrate their job qualifications without the stigma of a past record preventing it.
The legislation would allow for criminal background checks to be run once an application is accepted. Republican Don Wagner said the prohibition on asking about criminal convictions on an application would waste everyone's time.
We are told that you can still do all the background checks and you can still, if somebody has what you would consider to be an unacceptable criminal history, you can still deny them that job. But think about where we're now doing it in the process. We're doing it at the very end.
The measure passed the Assembly on a vote of 42 to 22. Nine states and over 50 California cities and counties already have adopted ban the box policies. The state Senate has rejected a bill that would have phased out the use of single-use plastic checkout bags in grocery, drug, and convenience stores. Democratic State Senator Alex Padilla said he'll try again next year. His bill fell three votes short in the state Senate. The measure had support from business groups that want to eliminate a patchwork of rules restricting plastic bags. More than 70 local governments already prohibit such bags. California retailers hand out an estimated 14 billion single-use plastic bags each year. Those bags pollute the waterways. Sea turtles, birds, fish, and mammals often mistake the plastic for food. Rebel reinforcements are attempting to join the bloody fight for the strategic Syrian town of Qusair. Opposition leader George Sabra urged rebels outside the town to come help join in the battle.
More than 1,000 fighters from the Free Syrian Army from all over Syria are now joining the resistance inside al-Qusair to defend it against the foreign terrorist invaders who are infiltrating our country from Lebanon and other places. Our fighters are flooding into al-Qusair to liberate it.
Lebanese Hezbollah fighters have joined the fight on the side of the government of Syrian President Bashar al-Assad. Assad said in an interview on a Hezbollah TV station he was confident of victory, and he warned Israel against any future airstrikes in Syria.
We will respond if any strikes take place. On a number of occasions, there were a number of violations of our skies, and we responded immediately. It's a world war being waged against Syria. We're confident of our victory.
Russia has promised to send advanced anti-aircraft missiles to Syria. Israel has threatened to attack any such missile shipments. The government of Qatar is backing new internet codes that widen controls over news websites and online commentary. The move comes after similar clampdowns by other Gulf Arab states. The Western-backed Gulf nations have sharply increased arrests over social media posts and charges that include insulting real rulers. Stronger media laws have been put in place as officials worry about growing opposition to authoritarian regimes. Qatar's measure would give wide leeway to punish websites or social media users for items considered a threat to state security or the general order. Al Jazeera English is funded by the Qatar royal family. Its reporting helped spur the so-called Arab Spring uprisings. Weather forecast for the San Francisco Bay Area, sunny, highs in the mid-70s to lower 80s around the bay, lower 90s in the warmest interior valleys. In Fresno and the central San Joaquin Valley, sunny, highs 90 to 95 degrees. You can hear expanded versions of our local news reports at PacificaEveningNews.org. I'm Eileen Elfenderry. I'll have more news at noon with headlines. Be sure to join us at 6 for the hour-long Pacifica Evening News.
Welcome to the Morning Mix. This is the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. I'm Mickey Huff in studio with Peter Phillips. Today, we'll be focusing on a number of events going on in the San Francisco Bay Area. We have many different activist summits, scholarly conferences, and we are delighted to showcase so many wonderful guests here this morning on the Project Censored Show. For our first segment, we'll be speaking with Birgitta Jonsdottir, founder of Icelandic Pirate Party, who was recently reelected to Parliament. And we hope to be joined by Mark Armstrong, who is the executive director of the Public Banking Institute. Public Banking 2013 is a conference that's happening June 2nd, 3rd, and 4th here in the San Francisco Bay Area. That's at Dominican University in San Rafael, and there's still tickets available at publicbanking.org. So we urge you to go to the website and check that out. This weekend conference here is really a who's who lineup in public banking. So we're going to be seeing people like Matt Taibbi, of course, Birgitta and Mark, who are our guests this morning. We'll also hear from Margaret Flowers, several others here this weekend. So we hope you can check that out, publicbanking.org. We are joined now on the phone by Birgitta Jonsdottir. Thank you so much. We know you just got in from Iceland not long ago.
Yeah, thank you. It's a long way from here. I'm very happy to be here and very excited to be a part of this conference.
Birgitta, this is Peter Phillips. Welcome. And public banking conference that'll be held this weekend at Dominican College. You're participating in that, and I assume you'll be talking about what's been happening in Iceland with mm-hmm. the banks there. Give us an update on that.
Well, in the wake of the financial collapse in Iceland, there was a recognition that everything we sort of put our trust in had failed, both the banking sector, the academia, the media, the politicians, and the regulatory system. We had just like a few years prior to the collapse privatized our biggest banks. And that was, of course, done in the same fashion as everywhere where the corporate and the political system is in an unhealthy relationship. So they have managed to expand to such a degree that we had the world's third largest financial collapse from the history of recorded banking collapses. So there was a big discussion in Iceland about what can we learn from this and what can we do to prevent it. That has, however, not expired into law yet. But we did one thing that was quite amazing, and I'm very proud of my nation for doing it, and that was when Holland and Britain demanded that the Icelandic taxpayers would shoulder private debt in order to pay them for a collapsed bank that had an Icelandic name tag in both these countries. We refused by using our system. We sort of hacked into our system and demanded a national referendum on both the contracts. And we said no, and then it was taken to a European court because we are part of the European Economic Area, and we won. Because if we would have lost, it would have basically said that all European countries are eligible to shoulder private debt as taxpayers' responsibility. So in a way, it was we recognized that the banks were not too big to fail.
Or not too big to jail then, eh?
Well, and then we actually put together, and this was another thing that was quite important, and it's not been recorded or reported enough. The Parliament, in the wake of the financial crisis, put together a special committee that was to investigate what went wrong. And as the Parliament requested this report, we got it like 2 days before the massive volcanic eruption in Iceland. So there was very little reporting on it. It just all went into discussing the volcanic eruption and the flight this eruption around the world. But in it, it was, we found that, and I was actually in the committee that was processing it, we found that two of the biggest banks, the people behind them never paid a cent. They just lent each other. And so it was a massive scam. And unfortunately, the people responsible for that have gotten away with it because they have not been thrown into jail, but rather the people under investigation were not the board people, but the people that were the bank managers. So we still have a long way to go. And I fear because we have a new government now that is exactly the same people that got us into the severe crisis, that they will cut down money to the special persecutor that is, they're doing very extensive research and persecution on the people responsible. It takes a tremendous amount of time because, of course, the people that created the crisis helped create the laws, and they wrote into the laws the loopholes, and you have exactly the same problems here in the United States.
Birgitta, could you explain to our listeners, there was a sort of this peaceful revolution in Iceland that took place, and there were media shields, media reforms, protections of the commons proposals, going after the so-called banksters, and you've founded something called the Pirate Party. And yeah. Could you tell our listeners a little bit about this? And then also, there has just been an election there, and now there are different people back in power. And I don't know if people here know the background of that.
Okay, so in the wake of the financial collapse, this was such a severe happening in Iceland. So most ordinary people felt it, and thus we got a massive protest on a very regular basis. Like, there were protests that grew every week for a couple of months until it sort of ended in a revolution where the parliament was under siege. And in a peaceful way, but there were still people burning, you know, Christmas trees from Norway and everything they could put fire to in a big bonfire just outside the parliament. And the demands of the people were that the government would resign. And they also wanted the head of the central bank to resign and the head of the financial regulatory system. And we got all of that. The fourth demand was that we would rewrite a new constitution by and for the people of Iceland. Sort of a constitution that would be the social agreement on what sort of society we wanted to build based on our very harsh wake-up call. And we got our first sort of left government that lasted for 4 years despite numerous attacks to try to remove them out of power by the old powerhouses of Iceland. And one of the things they did, and I actually, in the wake of the financial collapse, helped create a political movement that was just a movement, and it was just called the movement. We got 7.2% of the vote, even if we were only established 8 weeks prior to elections in 2009. And our main aim was to ensure, for example, there would be some that we would, for example, not socialize private debt, and that we would do this new constitution and have more transparency and accountability. And then the aim of that party was to dissolve after these 4 years, and which we did. And then I helped create a pirate party in Iceland. We were established in November last year, and we got 5% of the vote, which gave us 3 parliamentarians out of 63. And our aim is to have more transparency via, for example, the budgeting, also to bring more power into the parliament, because what has sort of happened, not only in Iceland, but everywhere where we have so-called democracies, is that the bureaucratic body and the ministers, they have acquired all the power, and all the laws are written there instead of at the legislative level, which is the parliament and the Congress and so forth.
Birgitta, we're so happy to hear how the people in Iceland have really stood up to these centralized banks, private banks, saying no to austerity, no to paying off the debt. We have on the line with us also is Mark Armstrong, who's part of the Public Banking Institute. Mark has been a consultant who's worked with IBM Finance, with both Bank of America and Wells Fargo. And then he read Ellen Brown's book, Web of Deceit. And he's a big participant now in terms of this public banking program this weekend. Mark, are you with us?
Yeah, good morning, Mickey. I am.
I'm Peter. Mickey's here with me. And we welcome you to the Project Censored Show. You heard part of what Birgitta was talking about, how the people in Iceland really stood up to the banksters and have somewhat taken control, or certainly stalled some of their plans for austerity and taxing of the people higher. Why can't we do that here?
Well, you know, it's interesting. You know, Birgitta was also talking about the need for transparency and how important that is. And right now, here in the States, we've given this very important privilege to banks. They basically have a license to create money out of nothing in the form of loans. And they can use that for the purposes, many purposes, which are considered to be good and socially responsible. But what they've done is really constrained that over the last 4 or 5 years. And so we've had this economic recession on Main Street because of this credit contraction. And there's very little transparency associated with these banks. And, you know, I think it does come down to a greater awareness of people here in the States that first of all, that the banks have been given the privilege by the people to create loans the way they do. They don't lend their deposits. That's a fallacy, by the way. So what they do is they create loans on the books. It's simply an accounting entry. They put money into circulation that way, and they have not done that. That's our debt. Our money-based system is based on debt like this. It's very important. And so as we become more aware of the importance of this franchise in the United States, this banking franchise, the question is, well, how can we better control it? And right now there's over $1 trillion of public monies that are basically being deposited in private banks, and it's being used for the benefit of the private bank shareholders. We think that that money can be put into public banks with an entirely new public banking network, 50 state-owned banks, countless county-owned banks, and that can be transparent, accountable, and basically use that money for the benefit of the people.
Well, Mark Armstrong, this is exactly what the plutocracy in Washington doesn't want, the banking establishment, Wall Street, and so forth. And the Public Banking Institute, of course, Peter mentioned Ellen Brown's book, Web of Debt. Ellen Brown will be at this conference this weekend, along with Matt Taibbi, Birgitta Johnsdottir, a number of people, Margaret Flowers. And Margaret Flowers has done some work here with us at Project Censored. We've also covered the South Dakota public banking story. You have a wonderful two-day program here. People can learn about it at publicbanking.org. Can you tell us a little bit about what's going to go on here at Dominican University?
Sure, I'll be happy to tell you. The key event is on Sunday night. That's where we have Matt Taibbi and Birgitta coming in to talk about what's going on with the large private banks as well as alternative models. You know, there are plenty of public banks throughout the world, just not in this country, with the exception of North Dakota, which has its own state-owned bank. Those tax revenues are put into their own bank. And they use that bank for their own public interest to further that. And so we'll be exploring that concept on Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, but particularly on Sunday night, where we have this 2.5-hour event discussing this. It's going to be a nice kind of multimedia event where we have presentations. Birgitta will be talking for 10, 15 minutes about her vision for having a more of a democratic society as it relates to our economic livelihood. And we'll be exploring that in conversation between Gar Alperovitz, Ellen Brown, Matt Taibbi, as well as Birgitta. And then there'll be specialized talks on Monday and Tuesday, as well as on Sunday afternoon. But people can go to publicbanking.org and find out more about it. We also have a speaker coming in from D.C. To talk specifically about plans for possible postal banks here in the United States. There are postal banks throughout the world. It's one way to save the Berkeley Post Office as well as every other post office throughout the country. And other countries have realized the importance of providing financial services through their post offices, and we can do the same thing here in this country.
Well, Mark Armstrong, thanks so much for joining us this morning, the Executive Director of the Public Banking Institute. This is a wonderful opportunity for people to learn about public banking. Birgitta Johnsdottir, founder of the Icelandic Pirate Party, thank you so much for your time and joining us this morning briefly. We wish you all the best, and again, welcome to this country. We hope you share your experiences with people, and we certainly hope that this takes some form here in the United States and grows beyond places like North Dakota and other local communities. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you very much.
After this short musical break, we will come back and talk about Moana Nui 2013. Please stay with us.
Thank you.
to the Project Censored Show in the Morning Mix. I'm Mickey Huff in studio with Peter Phillips. And here's Peter to introduce our next segment and our next guest. We'll be talking about the Moana Nui 2013 Peoples of the Pacific. There's a Confronting Globalization, Militarization, Resource Theft in America's Pacific Pivot, a two-day teach-in here at Berkeley. And our next two guests are to talk about this with us. Peter?
Victor Minotti is the executive director from the International Forum on Globalization, and which was founded in 1994. Victor has written and spoken extensively about the impacts of globalization on ecosystems and international networks around the world, traditional farming, forest fishing, and indigenous communities, and how that's impacted. There's a report called Free Trade, Free Logging, How the World Trade Organization Undermines Global Forest Conservation. Now, you're here. There's a weekend conference that's focusing on the Pacific and Pacific Islanders and various numbers of issues. Victor, can you tell us what's happening there?
Well, it's a reaction to America's Pacific Pivot, which President Obama announced about a couple years ago. That's the shift in U.S. military and corporate power from the Mideast and the whole Atlantic theater to the Pacific to encircle China, basically. And so what we have in Berkeley this weekend is speakers, about 45, 50 speakers from about 20 different countries all over the Pacific. And they're coming to talk about how this Pacific pivot is being felt on the ground in their countries, like Guam, Okinawa, where the U.S. has these big military bases in Guam. They want to expand them or establish one even more. We have the mayor of the island of Jeju, South Korea. How many Americans know that 500 miles from Beijing, the U.S. is helping South Korea to build a nuclear missile bases? You know, we don't hear any coverage of that about why, you know, is this the sort of thing that is, you know, helping North Korea to react the way it's reacting right now. So we're trying to wake up Americans, starting here with the West Coast, and connecting very closely with Asian Pacific Islander organizations, people's organizations here in the Bay and throughout California. And coming from across the Pacific are leaders from their communities, spiritual leaders, activists, legal authorities on indigenous sovereignty, because the issues are about protecting indigenous resources, lands, territories, through their proclaimed rights recognized by the United Nations, free, prior, informed consent, for instance. And how this is really the front line of resistance against America's Pacific pivot. They're here to wake up Americans, and we hope Berkeley turns out to help us fill this 900-seat auditorium at MLK Middle School Saturday and Sunday, 10 a.m. to 10 p.m. IFG.org is where there's more information about the event.
IFG.org.
International Forum on Globalization. Moana Nui is the word in Polynesian for big ocean. And that's how they conceptualize this liquid nation that unifies this Pacific community.
What is the, in the first segment here today, we were speaking about the public banking conference that's going on also this weekend with Mark Armstrong and also Birgitta Jonsdottir from Iceland. And one of the things we didn't get to talk to them about was the TPP, the Trans-Pacific Partnership. That's something that they'll be talking about also at their conference, and that's something that you'll be addressing here this weekend at this teach-in. Could you tell our listeners a little bit about that and what's going on with that and how is it relating to this Pacific pivot?
TPP, the Trans-Pacific Partnership, is what we call NAFTA on steroids, or the extension of NAFTA to the Pacific. It is President Obama's big trade initiative. It's, you know, how he hopes to plan to double exports, which is a big part of his whole economic plan. And it is the, I would call it the corporate prong of the Pacific pivot. If you look at the military might that the country has and what we're doing to encircle China, then this is how the TPP is how our corporations and investors would be accessing those countries' natural resources, commodifying them and selling them back to consumers or wherever they want to in the globe. Trans-Pacific Partnership, it includes about 10 different countries, excludes China. Although today we see that China is going to study what this TPP is going to mean for it. So what you see is some, the grand shift is in geopolitical positioning throughout the Pacific, but throughout the world of U.S. trying to deal with the rising China. And I think everybody is impacted by the fact that you know, scarcity of resources in the planet. We have to figure out how to share this planet, not just the atmosphere, the ocean, the fisheries, and this is what's up for grab right now. So our big concern is this is a drift to war with China. Eventually, unless we get hold of how we consume resources and help China to reimagine how its development path, as well as all the other countries in the region, but these two big elephants now dancing.
We've certainly been militarily encircling China for a long time. The Project Redoubt American Century a decade and a half ago really described the dangers of China's and their economic growth. And at the same time, we're seeing China kind of open their doors so that their folks with money can now invest in the stock market and invest through BlackRock assets management firm, which is the largest, now has hired a Chinese negotiator to allow for Chinese investors to invest in the stock market and global asset management. So we're seeing this. So there's kind of this hegemonic competition between China and the U.S., partly military, but also capitalist. And, you know, so many of the panelists that are coming are indigenous people from throughout the Pacific. You know, how do they feel about this hegemonic battle between the U.S. and China?
Walden Bellow will be there tomorrow, and he's in town already. We were talking about this just last night, and he will, you know, be talking more to the auditorium of at MLK this weekend, about how countries like his in the Philippines, he's now a member of Congress there, and is leading the charge within the Foreign Policy Committee to keep China at bay, because China is claiming resources in the South China Sea, mainly gas and oil resources. The U.S. military is there using Palawan and other islands as staging grounds for future possible, keeping China in line and basically, you know, protecting Chevron's oil rigs out in Vietnam and other offshore areas. So, you know, but what countries like the Philippines are, or at least what people, leaders like Walden are saying, just because they don't want China there doesn't mean they want the U.S. in there playing bully, which is what they see happening. They see the U.S. provoking China, humiliating again, not really allowing it the space to rise peacefully and have the respect it deserves in the region. And so, you know, they don't want to be caught in – they do want to keep the two powers at bay and play them off each other. But these balance of power politics, as Walden will be talking about, just have never really served the interests of peace or justice.
And this is this weekend here at the Martin Luther King Auditorium, 1781 Rose Street in Berkeley, June 1. It's a public teach-in for Moana Nui, and we're speaking now with Mark Menotti, and our other guest has just arrived. So, Peter, please introduce.
Christine Hong is a professor at the Literature Department at UC Santa Cruz, and she specializes in transnational Asian American Korean diaspora and really kind of critical studies on the Pacific Rim. And you're kind of specialized in Korea to a certain extent. Mm-hmm. Tell us about the conference you're participating in. What's your message going to be?
You know, my message is going to be that basically the fact that the Korean War is not over and the fact that the United States uses North Korea as a very convenient pretext to militarize the region, to maintain a long-standing empire of bases within the region, really destabilizes the entire area and has an adverse impact not only on the people of the Korean Peninsula, but people regionally. And so I hope that during this conference, it'll give me and others an opportunity to build solidarity and alliances to, not just resolve the Korean War for the Korean people, but to actually ensure a more meaningful peace within the region.
You're listening to the Project Censored Show in the Morning Mix. We're speaking with Victor Menotti. I misspoke before. Sorry about that.
It's funny. You called me Mark. My brother Mark is a colonel in the Marines.
Oh, well.
He's in the one. He's on the other sort of side of this Pacific.
So you are balancing out the family name.
In a way.
Yeah. We're also joined by Christine Hong. This is about the Moana Nui teach-in that's taking place here in Berkeley this weekend. Christine, since you were just able to arrive, we're really happy you could join us. Could you continue to talk a little bit more about what you hope to achieve this weekend?
Well, you know, I hope the area that I specialize in is Korea. You know, I really hope. I mean, we just recently this past year and just even a number of months and weeks ago witnessed a kind of escalation of tensions where it seemed that a resurgence of all-out war would be possible with North Korea, and the United States kept calling North Korea provocative while never ever commenting on its own massive military games, its own like moving of missile defense systems within the region, you know, and its own military pivot policy within the region. So that was totally uncommented upon. And so I think that we have to think structurally, systematically, and we have to think in terms of critical alliances in combating issues that seem to be sort of site-specific. And as I mentioned earlier, North Korea for many years has furnished a very convenient pretext for the United States to maintain this very aggressive forward-deployed military posture.
So if North and South Korea were to really make peace and work that, how would that impact the U.S.? How would that impact the Pacific Basin?
Well, you know, the U.S. has interests, you know, in the region. You know, even when the Korean War happened, most people in the, you know, it's an unending war. This is a war that has yet to be solved with a peace treaty. And, you know, at mid-century, when the Korean War was happening, most Americans had no idea where Korea was. And, you know, like, The purpose of the Korean War was multiple-fold. The Korean War consolidated the U.S. national security state. It consolidated the military-industrial complex. And it consolidated the United States' permanent war economy. And so the U.S. has always used the sort of the narrative of a dangerous, threatening North Korea to be able to sort of maintain its power within the region. So the U.S. would have that to lose, but the U.S. having that to lose means that the people of the region would have much to gain. And, you know, right now, like, you know, against a North Korean quote-unquote threat, South Korea is pursuing its own highly militarized sort of posture. And then you have over in Japan, you have a neocon hawk who's the son of a war criminal in Abe Shinzo, who also has his own sort of plans for militarization and also uses a powerful North Korea, an armed North Korea, as a kind of pretext. So once, you know, I think that there's a kind of resolution of this, there's not going to be the same kind of rationale for this escalation of militarism.
Victor Minotti, International Forum on Globalization, back to you. This is a really ambitious weekend that you all have planned. Just looking at the website and the names of everybody, and including, which I think is an incredible an important thing to note, so many people from the region, that you'll be hearing these perspectives. So it's not just people from outside of the region talking about it, which is what you see in the corporate media in the U.S. And Christine was just pointing out so many things that we don't seem to remember or aren't drawn out in the corporate media in the United States. An interesting thing, Victor, this idea of the forgotten war and, you know, what Christine just lumped all together, the military-industrial complex, the growth of what becomes both neoconservatism on one hand militarily, but neoliberalism on the economic side, right? So we have this merging in the 21st century, and this is all, it looks like it's all coming to a head in the Pacific region then.
Yeah, I think that's what you're seeing. That's why sort of the two prongs, the military and the trade and investment regimes, are sort of going together. It's either, you know, join this regime for resource exploitation and, you know, protecting capital, or, you know, deal with us as a military force. You know, several countries, Iran, Cuba, around the globe have experienced this, but now we're seeing it because China is becoming so powerful, you know, in large part fueled by foreign investment from the United States, and it's our transnational. So there are new, you know, relationships of power shifting around, but the old nation state and U.S. military power and corporate power with those built-in imperatives to have to access new resources all the time to keep the shipping lanes open to, you know, the Walmart and the Chevrons and others, and to access the consumer markets. That's really what is at play here. Those it's about the resources.
And we certainly covered those stories at Project Censored, and this goes back. There are so many other stories here that we could also extend to that, including in Somalia, the so-called Somali pirates, how right. This has been a dumping ground and an exploited state. I mean, really, if you kind of go across the map, I mean, cynically, foreign policy and warfare seems to be how Americans learn geography. But these people don't really have a real grasp on how broad and vast this is. And, Victor, you mentioned the TPP, the Trans-Pacific Partnership, NAFTA on steroids. You know, that coupled with this whole vague moniker of the war on terrorism, that sounds like a recipe for, I think you said earlier, that we're heading into a new era of global warfare.
Yeah, and the only thing to counter it possibly are peoples from the Pacific coming together, learning from each other's stories so we understand how this is being experienced, from the folks on the front line of where these violations are happening, of human rights, of culture, of ecosystems, and are forming our own coherent countervoice to this. That's why IFG has these teach-ins. That's why we're doing it here on the Pacific Coast. That's why we're flying in these folks from all over the Pacific. Very rare opportunity for Americans to hear about this. And this is where this counter-movement begins in the U.S. It's our peace and anti-war movements, together with the trade justice folks working on TPP and NAFTA and from all these different countries, as well as the food sovereignty, the Via Campesina, and folks, who live on the land, and the indigenous cultures. That's really the front line. Those are the voices that we see are really shouting to be heard, and that's what you'll be getting to experience firsthand and to meet these folks this weekend in Berkeley at the MLK Auditorium at the middle school. It goes all day Saturday, 10 a.m. to 10 p.m. On Sunday, goes 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. You could look at the whole program, almost 50 speakers at IFG.org. That's International Forum on Globalization. Tickets are right there on our website. And, it's a very rare opportunity. We did the one in Seattle before the WTO, and because we knew it was such an important issue and Americans had to learn about this. So, take advantage of this opportunity. I know there's a lot of great stuff going on in the Bay this weekend, but this is a rare opportunity.
Christine, back to you real quick. We just have like 1 minute left on this segment. But you're part of the Korea Policy Institute. You're in a working group on peace and demilitarization in Asia. I know that there's a kind of strategic partnership agreements between some of the Asian countries and NATO. Mm-hmm. And there's certainly this idea that NATO ultimately is going to be the global peacekeeping force. How do you see that, and what can we how can we resist?
I think it's such an unfortunate feature of the peace that isn't really a peace, that the idea of security is national security rather than human security, some sort of idea of a people's security. So I think that is just horrendous and laughable.
Last words here from the two of you. We only have about a minute left. Victor Minotti, will people be able to maybe see some of this event even if they can't attend? And if not, how else can they get more information and give your website one more time?
Yes, you can check out ifg.org. That's International Forum on Globalization, ifg.org. You can see tickets there. We'll certainly have videos of the full thing up there afterwards. So tickets, if you can't make it this weekend, check to ifg.org after this weekend.
Christine Hong, can you also, a few seconds here left, maybe give out a website and any last words about this? This sounds like an incredible opportunity about something that is very underreported, and also I know that a lot of people here will be pointing out some of the more obvious things, racism and classism, that's totally been afoot in these policies.
Yeah, you can go to kpolicy.org, and one last thing that I'd say is that the Korean War is referred to in the United States as the Forgotten War. Bruce Cumings says the United United States is the party of forgetting, North Korea is the party of memory. And what does North Korea remember? North Korea remembers that the U.S. committed an asymmetrical genocidal air war against North Korea at mid-century, and 3.5 million people in North Korea alone, 70% of whom were civilians, were killed. And that inaugurated a pattern of informal wars that the U.S. has prosecuted up until this present moment in the Middle East.
Christine Hong, thanks so much for joining us. Victor Minotti, thank you for joining us. We wish you the best with Moana Nui 2013 in Berkeley this weekend, and would like to have you back sometime in the future.
Thank you all.
Thank you.
We're going to be turning our attention next, after this short musical break, to more on real conspiracies. We've been hearing this morning about the alternative public banking, looking at, you know, global banking conspiracies, essentially. We just got done talking about the military-industrial complex merging with the global banking systems to exploit the Pacific. Next, we'll be talking to two scholars about state crimes against democracy and how we can talk intelligently about real conspiracies. Stay tuned.
Gonna do it, babe.
To the Project Censored Show. I'm Mickey Huff in studio with Peter Phillips. For our final segment today, we turn our attention to the topic of state crimes against democracy, and we are joined by two scholars, Professor Lance DeHaven Smith, Professor of Public Administration and Policy at Florida State University, and Aaron Good, PhD student at Temple University. They are attending and presenting a panel at the 26th annual meeting of the Public Administration Theory Network. That's PatNet 2013, hosted at the University of San Francisco and Cal State University East Bay. That's also this weekend in San Francisco. And Lance DeHaven Smith and Aaron Good are participating with several others on a panel called Between Rocks and Hard Places, Dystopias and Utopias of Cold War Camelot and Beyond. We're going to be addressing the Kennedy assassination and also many, many other things in terms of the U.S. history and really hidden histories in many ways, which is a similar theme here at the Project Censored Show. So, Lance DeHaven Smith and Aaron Good, thank you for joining us.
Glad to be with you. Thank you, Mickey.
Hello, Lance. This is Peter Phillips and Aaron. Welcome. Lance, one of the things you're going to be talking about is Charles Beard and Pearl Harbor. He's a well-known historian, active in the beginning of the middle of the 20th century. What was his ideas about Pearl Harbor?
He wrote a book in 1948, the year that he died, and what he said is that Franklin Roosevelt, the president, maneuvered the Japanese into firing the first shot and knew in advance that it would be at Pearl Harbor and it would be on December 7th, and did not notify the commanders in the Pacific, and then relieved the commanders from duty and blamed them for not being prepared. Beard's book was it was on the New York Times bestseller list for 3 months. I mean, this is an academic book, and bestseller is pretty unheard of. But it was never reviewed or mentioned in the Public Administration Review, the major journal for public administration that Beard had founded. And then Roberta Wohlstetter, who was the wife of a game theorist at the University of Chicago and RAND, people that were doing the nuclear deterrence policies, his wife Roberta wrote a book on Pearl Harbor that was a rejoinder to Beard and did not mention Beard. So it's like he was airbrushed out of history. It's just an amazing phenomenon. And that's a lot of what I'm going to be talking about at the conference, how this happened and how the field today, how the scholars today, this was the founder of public administration, the only scholar ever elected to be both president of the American Political Science Association and the American Historical Association, a giant in the field. And his last book is, he never wrote it. It just disappears down the memory hole. It's amazing to see this in real life and go back and look at it. But the scholars today would, you know, I'm reminding us of this. I didn't know it until I researched it.
Aaron, good. You were at Temple University, and part of the theme of this conference that your panel you're presenting is elite political kind of criminality and how elites engage in what you describe as state crimes against democracy, and literally get away with it, and it gets labeled as a conspiracy theory. Lance has a new book out, Conspiracy Theory in America. What are you going to be talking about at the panel today?
Well, I'm looking at the long-term effects on U.S. and world history of the Kennedy assassinations, most specifically the first Kennedy assassination. And I find that it is a turning point or a crucible of sorts for American democracy and really for a kind of benevolent U.S. hegemony after World War II. For some reason, a lot of scholars tried to argue that Johnson and Kennedy had the same foreign policies and that Kennedy's death was just this idiosyncratic thing that happened and not really meaningful in any sort of scholarly sense, just, you know, unfortunate. And I find that the differences were rather large between them. I mean, when Johnson takes over, the CIA sort of resumes the role that it did under the Eisenhower administration and begins overthrowing these democracies or, you know, emerging democracies in very crucial third world countries. And by the time he's done, the post-colonial world is back to a sort of neo-colonial track, and people like Sukarno in Indonesia are gone, Goulart in Brazil is gone, Kwame Nkrumah is gone. You have Lumumba, was killed under Eisenhower, but you have Mobutu running the Congo, which he did as a U.S. and Western client state for decades. And, of course, you have most famously Johnson's entry into Vietnam, which now we can, I think, say pretty safely that Kennedy was trying to extricate himself from that conflict thanks to Robert McNamara and McGeorge Bundy and other historians who have made this point. So it leaves us in a position as scholars to try to go back and really make sense of this history, and maybe even to try to make sense of why it's been sort of obscured to the degree that it has.
Well, Aaron Good, that's certainly something we've done here at Project Censored, and we actually published one of Lance's pieces in our 2011 book on state crimes against democracy. We might extend that to state and corporate crimes against democracy. A lot of the other people on the panel, Lori Manuel maybe isn't going to make it, but, you know, she's also been very important in this area. Matthew Witt is going to be convening. Certainly this is reminiscent for our listeners of the longtime work of people like Peter Dale Scott. Lance, your book, Conspiracy Theory in America, is on Mark Crispin Miller's series out of U Texas. And you mentioned Charles Beard. And the important thing about this, about understanding conspiracy theory in America, is really reclaiming that word away from its tainted modern origins through the Central Intelligence Agency, used as a weapon of sort to dissuade people people from doing dispassionate, scholarly, objective research, which what Aaron was just calling for. But if anybody really touches these third rail issues, you know, they're really confronted with a lot of name calling and attacks or marginalization. And this doesn't just happen on the right; it happens on the left and many of the progressive journals. And Beard suffered some of that fate that we see people today even suffering for daring to ask these questions. Lance?
Yeah, he did. He was. He wrote a book called The Economic Interpretation of the Constitution, which claimed...
In 1913.
Right, and it was very controversial, but he withstood the controversy, and in the academy was considered a giant, an intellectual giant. But after Pearl Harbor, and after America changed just dramatically during World War II. We became a full-fledged empire with a huge intelligence apparatus and bases all over the world, and scholarship just somehow, and I think that's the thing that Aaron and I are continuing to study, and Matt Witt and others, is how this happened. How was it possible to drive out logical questions about these defense failures and assassinations and election controversies, and this all gets brushed aside? And I think you can understand how it has to with the empire. The imperial authorities do not want any of these questions raised. But how does it happen, and how does it work its way through our mental constructs? And one of the ways it does is by the insertion of memes, of concepts like the conspiracy theory concept, that it was considered a legitimate thing. Beard had what was called the conspiracy theory of the 14th Amendment that said the amendment was drafted to include corporations. It was intentionally used the language that would lead the courts to give the rights of individuals to corporations. Nobody thought that that was a far-flung theory. That was just considered, yeah, that's a reasonable theory. But after 1964, after the Warren Commission report and the CIA program to popularize as a put down the conspiracy theory concept, it is no longer considered legitimate in academia. And that's part of what we're all trying to do. You have been working these fields a lot longer than I have, but I mean, the basic idea is let's recover that sense of criticism and that sense of realism and think clearly about our government. Quit being romantic about it and naive. We're basically, I think of us as similar to the USSR, a superpower with enormous control over the culture, using a lot of different methods to achieve that. And Project Censored is like a major thing. I mean, you're saying things that just simply do not get reported.
Well, Lance, you're here as participating in the 26th Annual Meeting of the Public Administration Theory Network. You're scholars. You are people with PhDs or near, and you're at universities all over the country. You're talking about the Kennedy assassination, but also in the context of Kennedy was proceeding to think about not going into Vietnam. He was proceeding with trying to build relationships with Castro in Cuba, and so he is, in fact, assassinated. There was motivation, the Korean War, the Vietnam War, to continue that military-industrial complex. And you examine this from a solid theoretical academic perspective. And we're very glad to have you on our show. And we're just about out of time here.
Yeah, Aaron Good, Lance DeHaven-Smith, I'm afraid we are out of time. But we definitely want to have you back on after the conference and have a protracted discussion about this very important topic. Thanks so much for joining us.
Great. Thank you all. Thank you, Mickey.
And we have one quick announcement. Peter Phillips and I will be speaking at the National Federation of Community Broadcasters Community Radio Conference, which is being held at the Park 55 Wyndham Hotel. That's downtown San Francisco. We'll actually be speaking there at 10:45 this morning about radical journalism and the importance of community radio. You are tuned to 94.1 FM KPFA, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, and online at kpfa.org. Thanks for joining us. Thanks to Rod Akeel and Anthony Fest. We're out.
This is the listing of upcoming events in the Bay Area for the week ending June 9th. All events are wheelchair accessible. Please listen closely for contact numbers. On Tuesday, June 4th, from 7 p.m. to 8:30 p.m., a panel discussion will be held about moving towards zero home waste. This event takes place at 525 San Anselmo Avenue, San Anselmo Town Hall, San Anselmo. This event is open to all ages. For details, call 415-258-4600. On Thursday, June 6th, from 7 p.m. to 8:30 p.m., author Carl Badle will discuss his new book, Local Protest Global Movements, Capital, Community, and State in San Francisco. This event takes place at 1680 Market Street, San Francisco, at Green Arcade Bookstore. For details, call 415-431-6800. On Saturday, June 8th, from 8 a.m. to 3 p.m., the Ohlone College Super Flea Market takes place at 43600 Mission Boulevard in Fremont. For details, call 510-659-6285. The community calendar is produced by members of the First Voice Apprenticeship Program. Send your listing at least 3 weeks in advance to KPFA Box 51, 1929 Martin Luther King Jr. Way in Berkeley, California, 94704. Or email us at calendar@kpfa.org. Tell us if your event is wheelchair accessible. To hear this calendar again, call 510-848-6767, extension 621. This calendar is also online at kpfa.org.